Well, good morning. Welcome to Valley Harvest Church. Would you stand with us as we begin singing this morning?
Joy to the world.
Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and light to all he brings, risen with healing in his name.
Be seated as my family comes to light the unity candle. Again, my name is Matthew Souter, and I have the privilege of leading worship here for the next few weeks. This is my wife, Kim, and our children, Sarah Joy, Mateo, and Jonathan.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this be since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth is in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her.
Let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. God, we just thank you for this season of Advent when we can be reminded and focus on your first coming to this earth, when you sent your son Jesus as a little baby. God, we just thank you for these reminders this time of year. We thank you for what that gift represented. The giving of your son so that he could be a sacrifice for our sins. God, we just ask that as we just continue to be focusing on you this Christmas season, that we would be like Mary. And even though she was fearful when she first heard the news, in the end her attitude was, "God, let your will be done through me." God, we just thank you again for your love. We thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Would you stand again with us, and the harvest kids and the grafted roots are dismissed at this time.
Sky, little lamb.
mighty King. Do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. People everywhere, listen to what I say.
Listen to what I say.
Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say.
Well, good morning, everybody. Like it or not, Christmas is just 3 weeks away. 3 weeks away, and another Christmas is already here. You could turn your Bibles to the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 6, where in a little bit I'll be reading from verses 6 through 10. It's hard to believe that Christmas is here already again. I was just remembering, you know, every Christmas there's some kind of controversy within evangelical Christianity. And I was just remembering last year someone had posted a rant and complaint that Starbucks had put out these cups that had no symbols on them. And they were saying it's because they hate Christianity, they don't want to put any Christian symbols. And I thought that was kind of interesting, in spite of the fact there is plenty of things in Starbucks that does say Merry Christmas. But, you know, there is this growing concern that I've heard over the years from the evangelical church about the secularization of Christmas, that it's becoming more and more secular every year, and as if this is something new. And, you know, something I've learned from studying history is that the secularizing of Christmas is not a new phenomenon that's unique to our 21st century consumer-driven mentality. As a matter of fact, if you study Christmas, the origins of how it became a celebration within the church are kind of spurious. We don't know exactly for sure. We don't even know exactly for sure what day Jesus was born. Clement of Alexandria, who was a church father, lived in the second century, was the first record that we have to make a possible guess, which he placed that Jesus might have been born maybe around May 20th. But it's not until you get to 336 A.D., that you have the first mention in history of a Christmas celebration on December 25th. And by the middle 5th century, the Eastern Church ends up following that practice and tradition. And it seems that Christmas as a celebration was originally intended to replace other popular pagan festivals. You had other pagan religions that Christianity came in and replaced. And there's the Feast of Mithra and Saturnalia were on December 25th. And what ended up happening was many of the pagan practices were simply incorporated and treated, they were Christianized into the church. And so you've got, you know, traditions like Saint Nicholas, who was just a saint known for his generosity, evolves into Sinterklaas, which becomes Santa Claus. And as early as the 5th century, you find a small minority of Christian leaders expressing their alarm and concern at the growing pagan character of Christmas And it became a cause for concern that led into the Middle Ages, to the point that when you get to the 17th century, which is just after the Protestant Reformation, the Puritans in England ended up outlawing Christmas celebrations. That carried over even into the United States and New England and Massachusetts as similar laws were passed. And so between the 16th and 18th century, many groups such as the Puritans and the Quakers, Baptists and Presbyterians were resisted attaching any religious significance to Christmas, which encouraged secular growth. So the secularizing of Christmas is not anything new. It's not something that's a new phenomenon to today. You know that Christmas has become big business, correct? Over the past 5 years, the Christmas season has generated over $50 billion every single year. And as we watch it happen, we see Christ-centered traditions tend to give way to consumer-centered type idolatry. So I entitled the message today, How Do We Live in a Consumer-Driven Culture? This is a time of year that you are bombarded by advertisements everywhere appealing to your inner nature to get and grab as much as you can to satisfy not only yourself but everybody around you and satisfy all the expectations. And how is a Christian supposed to respond to that? We've all been touched by the influence of secularism. How are we supposed to respond to that? Well, I think Paul here gives us some helpful words in 1 Timothy. This is a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to a young pastor in the church of Ephesus. Let's go ahead and stand as I read this, beginning in verse 6. Paul says, Now there is great gain in godliness with contentment. For we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. Let's pray. Master, I confess to you my own heart that is so easily led astray by the desire for stuff, that I am so easily discontented, and I ask that you would forgive my hard heart, that you would help us here today to find that true contentment that comes from knowing you. In your name I pray, Jesus, amen. You may be seated. Paul here is urging Timothy to teach the church a few things, particularly as it has to do with, you know, how we deal with money and the place of that within the church. But this passage could well extend beyond just the touch of our attitudes towards money. I think this is very fitting in this time during this season because this becomes a time of year that we tend to spend the most money, isn't it? And it's easy to fall into the traps that come our way continually every year. So Paul encourages Timothy here in verse 6. He says that there is great gain in godliness with contentment. Paul's advice here on how to respond in this culture that is driven by consumerism is that we need to continually bear in mind the source of contentment. The contentment doesn't come as the Grinch said from a box or a store. Perhaps at Christmas is something much, much more. No, I'm not going to quote Dr. Saul's sermon. But the Christmas is not just, you know, it is something more. I do like that story, The Grinch, because it really does get at the heart and the problem of this consumer-driven attitude toward this time of year. And Paul here is saying, Timothy, you've got to know, you've got to teach your people that contentment comes from somewhere else. What does it mean to be content? Well, it means to be at peace. Today we light the Advent candle representing peace. It means to be at peace and to be happy and contented, contented life that is happy and a peaceful life. So Paul says here, he gives us our first hint here, and that a godly lifestyle leads to contentment. If you want to know the source of true contentment, Paul tells us here in verse 6 that there is great gain in godliness with contentment. Notice that Paul says, you know what, you want to gain things in life, and that's not bad. It's not bad to want good things, and it's not bad to want to live a happy life. But notice where the source comes from, and he says here in verse 6 that there is great gain in what? In godliness with contentment. Not just godliness, because you can be a god, you can have this appearance of godliness and not be very content. We all know people like that in church, right? Don't look at anyone and point at them either. You were really thinking about it, weren't you? That's why you're so quiet and didn't laugh. There, you know, that there's this godliness that we ought to strive for in being content. And notice what the means of that contentment is. It is godliness. And so Paul is saying that there is this craving in life for more, isn't there? There's this craving in life for material things and material wealth, and that godliness will help us overcome those cravings by producing great spiritual wealth inside. So Paul says actually a chapter earlier in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, he says that bodily training is for some value, but godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Are you content? Are you at peace? Paul is saying that if you are not, then the place to begin is to examine where you are living your life in relationship to God and your view of God. And I find that our culture drives us exactly the opposite direction, does it not? A consumer-driven mindset ignores the source of contentment. Why? Because it's never enough. It's never enough. You can have and buy and we're constantly appealed to and bombarded, and you need this to be happy, and we're bombarded every day. I mean, guys, Christmas season, Christmas advertising now starts before Halloween. I even see the stores lined with Christmas decorations. Why? Because it's big business. And it's not that I'm not opposed to people making money, but we need to guard our hearts. That stuff will never bring contentment that godliness brings, because it'll never be enough. So Paul says in verse 7, for we brought nothing into this world, and we cannot take anything out of this world. Notice that if the source of true contentment, we said, was a godly lifestyle leads to contentment, but a lifestyle that focuses on eternity leads to contentment. A lifestyle that focuses on eternity, Paul says, we brought nothing into this world. Did anybody come into this world with clothes on? No, right? You're born naked. And you're going to leave this world naked. Now, if I do your funeral, I'll make sure they put clothes on you, okay? Don't want to see that, or it'll be a closed casket. But still, we're not taking nothing with us. And if I think that my life, the sum of total of my life, is going to end when this heart inside this chest stops beating, I've only got, if I'm blessed, possibly maybe 80 to 100 years. I think, Curly Hubbard just passed away. He lived to be 104. But 104 years is actually not that long of a time to make my mark, is it? And how am I supposed to be content when there are so many expectations, so many goals that I want to achieve in life that, quite frankly, I never hit. I never hit the expectations I set for myself. I don't know, maybe you like me, maybe you're not, but when I had certain goals that I wanted to hit by the time I was 30, and guess what? When I got to be 30 years old, I wasn't even where I thought I should be. Not financially, not my career advancement. And so I had these goals of where I thought I should be when I was 40. You know, I'm 2 years past that, and I can tell you it's not what I thought it should be. And so how are we supposed to find contentment if we're always living for the temporary? You know, the Bible gives us this worldview that allows us to live for something beyond ourselves, this promise of eternal life. And Jesus even promises eternal rewards that will be with us when we endure to the end. In Matthew chapter 19, Peter and Jesus are having this conversation, and Peter says, "Master Jesus, we've left everything and followed you. What are we going to have?" And Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man comes, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive a hundredfold and inherit eternal life." You hear Jesus calling you and I with this promise, with this appeal. It's almost like an advertisement, appealing that there is this life beyond, and that there is reward beyond. Don't live for this stuff. There is a reward coming to you who are faithful. He says, as he gives this parable in chapter 25 of Matthew, verse 32, talking about the Son of Man who will come back. He says, "Before him," that's this king, the Son of Man, which will be Jesus. "Before him will be gathered all nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep on his right, but the goats on the left. And then the king will say to those on the right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you for the foundation of the world.'" Notice that Jesus is again appealing to us that there is a kingdom that you and I can inherit. And if you want to live a contented, peaceful life, learn to live for eternity. Quit living for your life for the ultimate gratification now before you die. And so, again, a consumer-driven mindset focuses on what? Focuses on immediate gratification, does it not? Just look at how much debt we have in our society. Do you know that America has doubled its debt, its national debt, over the past decade? We now are in debt $20 trillion. The average American family in 2016 is carrying, on average, $15,000 of credit card debt. That doesn't include car loans. That does not include mortgages. We are an indebted nation. And we're constantly bombarded by this mentality that I have to get it now, I have to get it now. And perhaps our sense of urgency to consume is driven by the truth in this verse. It's like, I can't take anything with me, so I better enjoy it all I can right now. And that is completely backwards from what Christ teaches us. And so you grab all you can, and you can all you grab, have to go rent more storage space and get everything you can. And I find it just leads you to more stressful lifestyle. So Paul says we can't bring anything into this world. We can take nothing out. We note that the source of contentment is a godly lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that focuses on eternity. But notice also that a lifestyle that is simple will lead to contentment. A lifestyle that is simple. In verse 8, he says, "But if we have food and clothing, with these we shall be content." You know, it's amazing to discover how little you can live on. Has anyone ever seen any of that shows at Tiny Houses, I think it's called, where a couple will downsize extremely and have this little tiny house built for them and learn to live in, like, you know, 400 square feet? So I was thinking about that, and it inspired me. So I was asking Wendy, you know, we have 7 people in our family. We could do it. And Wendy was like, "I don't think so. That will never happen." I agree, you know, it's nice. I'm thankful for what I have. But in all honesty, we can all simplify a little bit, can't we? Can we not? He says that we should be content with what? With having food and clothes. Now you tell me, if that's all you have, would you be content today? Paul wouldn't tell us to do this if God himself did not equip you and I to have that kind of peace, to have that kind of happiness, to have that kind of joy in life, that if I didn't even, he didn't even mention shelter, that if my home is under the stars, but I have clothes and I'm fed, that I should be content with that, then there's something to this. And yet, I find, again, our culture, our consumer-driven culture, it has a mindset that ignores simplicity. You've always got to have more. You've always got to have more. And I find that the more stuff I have, the more stressed out I get, even if it's all paid for. Because in my mind, I got to justify owning it. You know, if I have two jet skis in the garage, which I don't, so you're going to have to invite me over if you have them, I'm going to stress out if I don't get my use out of them during the summertime. And I'm a busy guy. And I know that I probably, and so I find the more stuff I have, the more upkeep I have, the more stressed out I get. And Paul is calling us to a simplified lifestyle. And so we've said here, how do I respond when I live in a consumer-driven culture? We've said, number one, that I need to bear in mind the source of contentment. And that contentment comes from living a godly life. It comes from keeping an eternal focus and from keeping it simple. But in verse 9 and 10, Paul also encourages us to not trust the desires to have more than we need. Well, see, we have this desire to constantly consume. It's inbred in us. And he says in verse 9, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and to a snare and to many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into destruction. Notice that a consumer-driven mindset leads to sinful entrapment. See that word snare there in verse 9, first part of verse 9? That word snare is actually referring to a trap that a hunter sets to catch its prey. And you know, I spoke about this actually last summer in another message, and when we talked about being offended and how that can entrap us. And this word here is the same word. And it literally means that there's something waiting for you to catch you. And one thing I know about hunting, even though I'm not an avid hunter, is that when you catch a set of trap up like that, typically the trap is set up that the more the animal tries to get away, the more tangled it becomes up, the more entrapped it becomes into that snare. And I find that those, Paul's saying that those who desire to have more and more fall into this temptation, that we become entrapped into it. And the trap is this, is the desire to be wealthy is, it's tricky to define that because wealthy, to be wealthy is relative, isn't it? It depends on where I'm measuring myself. I don't care where you're at here in the United States. If you, matter of fact, I did my numbers 2 years ago, and I learned that if you are a welfare recipient in America, you are living in the top 20% income bracket of the world. In other words, 80% of the world's population is making much less and faring far worse than anyone, than someone in our nation living on assistance. Because wealth is, it's relative to what we measure ourselves against, isn't it? And so we're constantly looking to someone else, engaging ourselves, engaging our lifestyle and how we live with other people. And it's always fluctuating, isn't it not? And you know that those people, they're not showing you the true picture. You're not seeing what's going on behind closed doors. And so there is this trap that comes and being in loving wealth. And, you know, some of us don't have that wealth, do we? So what do? Credit cards. We don't have the kind of money, or we have it, we just don't want to spend it because we're greedy. And so we go get credit cards. Like I said earlier, I mean, it's become a national epidemic in America. And if you know as well as I do, so you go out and spend and run that credit card up. I did some dumb things when I was younger, okay? So if you're in good company with me. I get it. And I remember years ago, I could make the Lucases for 1 month look like we had, you know, we were living high on the hog thanks to some credit cards. But you know what? The month after, reality set in. And I'm going to tell you what. Talk about feeling trapped. Talk about being strapped and feeling miserable and have to have those conversations. It's miserable. So Paul says that we fall, that when we desire to be rich, wealthy, we fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires. Notice also that a consumer-driven mindset leads to harmful desires. It leads to harmful desires, that it leads us to these many senseless and harmful desires. You ever find that the more you want, the more you get, the more you want? Isn't that just the truth? The more I get, the more I want. You know, whether you wanted the girl or the guy, you got the girl or the guy, and what, a year, 2 year down the road, you're thinking, man, I thought there was a little more of that package back then. Correct? You want the house, and you're thinking, man, I want the house, and if I could just have that picturesque place to live, I would have something to work on, and I'd be happy. And guess what? You got the house. You're happy? No, I've got to have more stuff. I've got to go to Pier 1 Imports and decorate it, right? I've always got to have more. And so this desire for wealth, it leads us into these harmful desires. And a consumer-driven mindset leads to destruction. At the end of verse 9, he says that that these people plunge themselves into ruin and destruction. So, my friends, living this kind of life and trusting your desires, you set yourself up for failure. One thing I know as a Christian, I hear a lot of people, even in the church, say, trust your instinct. Trust, you know, go with your heart. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. The Bible tells me to do the exact opposite. If I trust my heart, guess what? I'm going to go do some things I shouldn't be doing and get in trouble. Because my heart tells me to do some things that are bad. And they might seem good at the moment. They might seem like fun and good at the good idea at the moment. But later, I pay the price for it. Jeremiah 17:9 says that he who says that the heart of man is deceitful above all things. Proverbs 28:26, that he who trusts his heart is a fool. And so people plunge themselves into ruin and destruction. That destruction, what is it? It's both this temporary destruction. Again, you know, when I'm not content, I won't live a happy life. But he's also, Paul is speaking of this eternal destruction. Jesus says in Matthew 6:24 that no one can serve two masters. For he will either hate the one and love the other, or will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. And in other words, he's saying, you keep trying to do this. You keep trying to court me like I'm your boyfriend in the background while you're over here doing this, and you're giving your heart to this. And what happens to you and I when that happens? You and I really aren't connected. You and I aren't what you think we are. Oh, we've got the title together, but, you know, there's something missing, and you're not content. Friends, when we give our hearts over to just follow them wherever they go, they'll lead you astray. They'll lead you astray. It'll lead you to ruin and destruction. Jesus also says in Matthew 19, after speaking to this rich young ruler who had a lot of wealth, and he asked the Lord how to inherit eternal life, Jesus tells him, sell everything you have and come and follow me. And the young man walks away sad because he had a lot of wealth and he wouldn't do that. And Jesus, his disciples ask him a question, and Jesus responds, truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I'm going to caution you. Don't you sit there and think, well, that's not me. I'm not rich. What did I just tell you? If you're an American, we're living on welfare, you're in the top 20% income bracket of the world. Now, if that's the case, what's that tell me about what is stepping between me and entering the kingdom of heaven? It's this. It's my lack of contentment, and it's me trusting desires that lead me just to want more and more. And so Paul gives an illustration of this in verse 10. He says, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some people wander away from the faith and pierce themselves with many pangs." This idea of piercing is kind of like the idea of fishing. You go fishing and you use a hook and it catches them and it hooks them. And I remember as a little kid having to rip those hooks out, wondering if it hurt the fish. It looked like it probably hurt. I remember getting hooks stuck in me as a kid and having to go to the ER. And it's painful. And Paul is saying that when you give in to these desires, that when you do not rein yourself in, that you set yourself up to live this painful life. See, notice that it's not here. Notice that it's not money. This verse is one of the most misquoted verses I've seen. I've seen Facebook posts that said, you know, people who are antagonistic towards the church to say, well, if money is the root of all evil, then why does the church ask for it? Well, that's not what it says. It says the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Money's not bad, my friends. I'm not telling you, the Bible's not telling you not to have money. It's not bad, but it's just a tool that God blesses you with in order that you might be able to live and bless your family and bless other people. And so notice that it's not money that is a root of all evil, but it's the love of money. It's the root of all kinds of evil. And so in verse 11, we find that Paul says to Timothy, "But you, O man of God, flee these things. Flee these things. And pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness." And he says, fight the good fight of faith. You want to know how to live and how to respond to a consumer-driven culture that is continually tempting you to buy into this game with them? Learn where contentment comes from. It comes from living a godly life, a life that has an eternal focus and that keeps it simple. And it comes from not trusting your desires to have more than you need. But my friends, you have got to be in the fight. You've got to fight for it. Paul says to Timothy, man of God, flee these things. And I find that a man of God is known by what he flees. There are things that he ought to run from. You know, just like he's known by the very things that he seeks to eliminate from his life. And so to flee from something means that we're being chased by whatever it is that we are running from. What's chasing you? Well, these things, according to Paul, it's the love of money. My friends, there's a time and a place for us to run. The Bible does not encourage us to always stand and fight. And there's a time when the best course of action is to flee. But notice also he says that a man of God is known by what he follows after. In verse 11b, he says, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. He's known by what he pursues after. You know, the things that you run after show what you value. We know what you love. Just have to have a conversation with you. And whatever you talk about the most, I guarantee you that's what you love the most. Kind of revealing a little test, isn't it? We could flip that around. Whatever you post on Facebook the most is what you love the most. That might be a little too guilt-ridden there. But Paul says that a man of God is known by what he follows after. And he says in verse 12 that we ought to fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Guys, friends, you are called to put up this fight and you are known by what you fight for. You are known by what you fight for. And the Christian life is not a passive game whereby we wait for God to do all the acting. This is the danger of being super spiritual, is that we say, oh, I trust the sovereignty of God, and indeed I do. I will make a much greater emphasis on the sovereignty of God over my actions every single time, because I realize I could do nothing apart from him. But I also know that God does not expect me to sit around and say, I'll just wait for God to take care of it. I'm at peace. lot of lazy Christians out there. I've been there myself. You don't just sit around and wait for things to happen. The Bible does not call me just to sit still and wait for God to provide my next meal for me. He calls me to get up and go find work. He calls me to go up and find that meal. He doesn't call me just to sit around and wait for the next job just to open up. If he's calling me to another job, he's calling me to keep my eyes open. He doesn't call me just to sit around and wait for Mr. or Mrs. Wright to walk into my life as I waste decades being lonely. He calls me to wait upon him. But there's even an active role I play. I'm being careful how I say it, but there's an active role that we play in waiting on the Lord. So he finishes up in verse 13 by saying, I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, this is the charge, keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. What are you and I to do? We are to be known by what we are faithful to. And this charge that Paul is giving to this young pastor, it lights me up because I just hear it. He's saying God is present with you, Timothy. He's there with you, and he's the very one that gives life to everything. And I'm charging you in the presence of Christ Jesus. Remember who Jesus is? He stood before Pontius Pilate. He was the one who gave the final orders for Jesus to be crucified. And Jesus stood there and confessed the truth that he was the king of the world, that his kingdom was not of this world, but that he was a king indeed. He didn't shirk. He didn't back down when trouble came. He stood. He fought the good fight. And you know what? Fighting that good fight, he took all the pain for you and I. He went to the cross. Why? Because of something he did? No. If anyone in the world had the right to run away from difficulty, it was Jesus. He did not deserve what he got. He didn't earn it, and yet he stood it. He looked death in the eye. Why? Because Hebrews says, for the joy that was set before him. What? He's being crucified. He's being plunged, tortured, and there was joy. What was that joy? That he would bring many sons and daughters to God. Amen. He fought. He didn't just sit around. He made it happen because we can't do it. That's the kicker, is that you and I can't do it. We can't save ourselves. We can't make ourselves right with God. You can't keep his commandments. And so Jesus pays that penalty. And paying that penalty, he makes it possible for you and I to be made right with the Father. And that's the good news I want to share with you today. You live in this consumer-driven culture. By keeping your eyes on the one who made the good confession before Pontius Pilate. You keep your eyes on him, and we keep the commandment unstained and free from the reproach until what? Until he comes again. Christmas is about the first coming. Guess what? It's also about him coming again. I am perplexed by history. I ask the Lord all the time, why didn't you come back yet? And then I'm saying, thank you that you didn't, because if you would have answered people 200 years ago, I would have never been born. I don't know why. I just know the Bible tells me the day with the Lord is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day, and he's coming again. You better get right with him. You better get right with him. I'm going to ask the team to come forward. You would come forward, and you know, one thing that has this effect of setting you and I free from these harmful desires that exist within our heart is worship. Don't get the idea that God needs you and I to worship him like somehow the super heavenly ego needs to be stroked by you and I saying, oh, you're so good, you're so good. No, the Bible's very clear. God doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. But he loves us and he calls you and I to worship him, not because he needs it, because you and I need to see what is truly worthy in this world. And that's the glory of God, that God loves you enough to take your place and to call you into this life. So I'm going to be in the back as a team leads you in a song of worship. And if you've not asked Christ into your life, if you've not surrendered to him, today could be your day. You just come back. You come back, I'll be there, I'll pray with you. If someone else is there, please be patient and wait. Just let God do business with you. Let's pray. Lord, this is exciting to talk about, and I thank you for the certainty that you are among us, that you're calling us, that you will set us free from the love of everything that seems to weigh us down. I ask you, work in your people. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen. Stand with me.
At your feet, oh Lord, is the most high place. In your presence, Lord, I seek your face. I seek your face. Down at your feet, down at your feet, oh Lord, is the most high place. In your presence, Lord, we seek your face. We seek your face. There is no higher calling, no greater honor than to bow and kneel before your throne. I'm amazed at your voice. At your feet, oh Lord, is the most high place. In your presence, Lord, I seek your face. I seek your face. Down at your feet, oh Lord, is the most high place. In your presence, Lord, we seek your face. We seek your face. There is no higher calling, no greater honor than to bow and kneel before your throne. I'm amazed at your glory.
Harvest family, it's that time again. It's the Christmas season, and the Harvest Kids and Company are getting ready for a musical, and we're working diligently, and today we're here to talk about why we're excited about this year's program. Sierra, what's your favorite thing this year?
Probably the kids having parts that fit their personality and just having a good time.
Lisa, favorite thing?
I really like the music. I think the kids really enjoy it too. It's really upbeat and it's easy to memorize.
We're excited because this year's message is different, it's fresh, it's new, but the reality is it's the message that we're missing here in Chachala. It's the story about Jesus, about a gift that some people have never opened. We're celebrating on December 17th at 6:30. And also on December 18th at 6:30, we want you to come, but most of all, we want you to accept this gift. And if you know someone who hasn't accepted it, then we want you to invite them so that they too can have the gift that we've already accepted.
It's the gospel truth.
Come join us. We're gonna share the story of the gift. Mom, the gift of Jesus. I can't wait.
Wendy and Uncle David get me a peach goat. I want it for my whole life. And I want an anthill and you eat my spaghetti all day. And that's all I want for Christmas.
I want a pony. I really want a pony. Ponies are cool. I love ponies. I want a pony with a heart on the forehead. I want a pony. I want a pony. A white pony with a pink heart on its forehead. A pony! I want a pony!
And then I want to eat all the food for Christmas dinner, and the food's all warm, and I just want it. But what if someone comes in my house and robs us, and they just take all of our presents, and then I'm going to have to wait 365 days just to get them again?
Ooh, I want a piano to play so I can get all the girls. Wait, no, I can't do that because then I'll mess them all up. Oh, I want Kylie Jenner cosmetics because they're so adorable. Oh, and I want them Yeezys 350 boost, because then I'll be 300. Oh, and I want weights. Wait, no, I don't want weights because I don't have to work out, and then I'll be tiring. Okay, I don't want weights. Wait, what if I don't get any of these things? What if I get just underwear, and not just any underwear? What if I get Fruit of the Loom? I can't have that.
Christmas Eve wasn't meant to be so stressful. So relax and take some time out of your busy schedule to join us Christmas Eve at 7 p.m., where we will worship the one who took our burdens upon himself. And don't forget, Christmas morning, we'll be having one service at 10:45 where we will reflect upon our great God who left heaven to become one of us. So take some time out of your busy schedule, join us, invite some friends. This is a great opportunity for others to hear the good news about Jesus.
Let's close in prayer. Father God, thank you for sending your Son to save us from this world. Thank you for the promise and the hope of eternal life with you. Thank you, Jesus, for teaching us in a way that no one else has ever taught before. I ask that you would bless our week, help us to keep our eyes fixed on you. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you for